Thank you. So yeah, really nice to see you all here on the Sunday, and I'm really excited to kick off this Berlin dance event at the Riverside Studios. I hope yesterday was fun at the after night events. But today we will dive into melodic sound design and arrangement. My name is David, and I've been making music for about 8 years under the alias Rezident. But my first release was about three years ago. Since then, I've released a couple tracks, and hopefully I will release more tracks in the future. I chose the topic melodic sound design because it has always been quite essential for my own work in music. There are some people who start with drums or grooves and stuff like that, but for me, I always started with a melodic idea that is always the center of the track. Here are a couple of my songs. For example, this one is, I think, the best one on like Spotify. And so on, and then like an arp comes in. And so on, and since that, it's pretty crazy because this has been, it has been released in 2018, now it's 2021. So since I made that track, I made also lots of other tracks, and I've collected some cool techniques and workflows that I would like to share with you. And I think the best way to show that is to just dive in straight into projects that I'm working on right now. These songs aren't finished, they're not mixed. They are very much in the stage of songwriting and sound design and arrangement. However, I have put some work into them already, and there are different versions. And I want to show you how I work with them and how I name all my tracks and how I make the sound design. So first, I want to start with a session that is not in a very amazing state, and I can show you why. This track is M247. It's a number because I like to, you know, call my tracks numbers, because then you can in the end decide for a name. Otherwise, if you have to pick a name right in the beginning and then, you know, the track changes or the meaning of it changes or you get vocals in the end, then the track is called something else, and then it's just becoming a big mess if the track has been called one name and then becomes another name, and then you have 20 versions, and that's why it's a number. It looks a bit like a machine code or something, but it's actually very convenient to work with. So this is the session. And I think this is actually like a bad example of a session that I would personally not like to work in. My tracks always look like this, and I think all our tracks always are a bit chaotic when we make them. This is what this track sounds like. So yeah, it's still very much in the early stages. The main element is this arpeggio. And there are some cool parts with it. However, the problem with the session is I don't know where anything is. If I want to work on the arpeggio, it's here, but it's not labeled anything. I don't know where the drums are. I don't know where the bass is. So I believe for melodic sound design or creative work in general, it is one of the most important things to actually have some order in the tracks, because only then can you really jump in and actually get any work done. So what I would suggest is that you make it a habit to consistently, after being creative and making a mess, going through all the tracks, name all of them, color them, and make the session as simple as you can, so that it becomes a a joy to work with and not a, you know, not a bad thing. For example, here's one session that I have organized, and the others are organized as well. And again, this is not necessarily about the quality of the track. They're all not fully finished. But if someone told me, okay, I have to finish this track now, I would have much more fun doing so. It's still opening up. It's a song with a vocalist. I don't know if we will keep the vocals or not, but this is what it sounds like. Actually load it up, I'll just play it here. These cuts inside my mouth from nearing out too much this time. Take out of here, starting up the engine, driving around the edge of town, lost look. Down a ghost I'd never meant to find. I don't need no one to tell me. A smile on your face that lets me know I'm lovely. Need to write out words before we tell our stories. I don't need no one, but I know I need you. I don't need no one to tell me. A smile on your face that lets me know I'm lovely. Need to write out words before we tell our stories. And then it goes on, and then this is the drop basically. Now this one. And yeah, then it goes on. By the way, if you have any questions about like something specific, maybe that I open up or that you see, you can just ask them. But my point on this project file is that here I find it a lot easier to actually do any sound design or any arrangement stuff because everything is laid out very nicely. I have drum groups, which we won't focus on in this presentation, but we also have a group for the bass. We have a group for all the lead elements. The main lead is this one. And we have all the individual sounds here as well. So I want to use this track here as an example for a technique that I really like to use, and it's using delays with a very strong feedback. This is, for example, the sound without the delay. And then with the delay from Valhalla, which is an amazing plugin, it actually does amazing reverb. I use it as my favorite reverb plugin, even though it's a delay. But with the delay, it's set to 1/4 of a note, and it has a super high feedback and 50% mix, so it's super strong. And 1/4 note is also exactly the duration of these notes. So essentially, you're creating a chord out of a monophonic sequence of notes, which is also very convenient when working with analog equipment, which is a lot of the time it's mono, or most of the time. So with delays, you can sort of fake some chords that haven't been there before. And ideally, when you make melodies like this, you already have the delay on the track, or at least for me, I do that often, because it makes it easier to evaluate how the chord progression is going to work. So with the delay, it sounds like this. And I think that's musically a lot more interesting than without the delay. When it comes to arrangement, it's also important to say that this part, even though I really like the sound, it's not in there all the time. It's just in the song, in the intro, in the break, in the build, but not in the drops. That's the case with a lot of electronic music. Oftentimes you have just one chord progression going on throughout the whole track, but then the magic really becomes arranging it into something that stretches over 5 minutes and doesn't become boring. So if you have some cool elements, don't have them all playing at the same time. Either save that for the drop to have everything playing at the same time, or maybe never have everything playing at the same time. This could create like a tension between a verse and a drop if the instrumentation changes between those parts. Another useful technique is, as you can see here in the break, the bass note plays one note instead of the whole progression. Nothing crazy, but it makes a big difference. So usually this is what the bass plays. It's going to play it for 31 seconds. And this creates some space to introduce new elements. For example, during this time, the lead element slowly comes in. There is an automation here on the frequency filter. So even if you have only one chord progression going throughout the whole song, which is the case with many electronic music tracks, you can still create some space by having the bass just playing one note for a longer segment. Usually it would be the key, the root note of the song. So in this case, it's F sharp, which is the key of the song. And this is super easy, and it can really bring some tension into any track if it makes sense in the right place. Another really cool thing to do is these vocal shots that you heard, these ones. It's a random sample. From Splice, as you can see, it's a really long vocal line. But a lot of the times people focus on new synths and new stuff like that, but somehow the old stuff is really interesting. And a lot of the coolness of the sound comes from the fact that it's looping, and the loop is super random. It's not on time, it's not on beat, as you can hear. It's doing something, I don't know what it is, but it's certainly not on time. However, oftentimes this is the magic. So another piece of advice would be to experiment and to do stuff that's not on time on purpose sometimes, and then take some snippets that you like and arrange them back, and you will have something a lot more interesting and organic than what you started with. And there's zero other effects on this, just a delay as usual. You will see this delay often. It's a great plugin. You should try the ghost verb. It's really nice. But all the reverbs here are great. Yeah. And as you can see, it's basically, the whole song can be divided into just a couple elements that you can easily hear, not more than four at a time. We have the vocals, we have the bells, we have this lead, and we have the bass, but there is not happening a lot more than that. And there shouldn't, because we can't focus on more than those things at once anyway. The next track I want to show you is a kind of more disco-ish track. It's called Your Song. This is what it sounds like. So the most important thing that I want to like show in this session is that the bass is from Kontakt, if you know, like it's a sampler plugin. However, I think all these expensive plugins in terms of CPU come with a high price. because they make your session unresponsive and unstable sometimes, and really just a mess to work with. If you think about like devices or hardware or instruments that people really love, that people are excited about, that people use to do songwriting, and have been using them for hundreds of years, like a piano or a guitar. But this also includes modern equipment, maybe like the OP1 that a lot of people love, or some electron gear. You always see people saying that they love this piece of gear. And all these pieces of gear have a lot of stuff in common, because in one, they're very responsive. If you pick up a guitar, you wouldn't expect a 1 second delay until you hear the note after playing it. They're always stable, you know, you wouldn't expect your guitar to like crash or disappear. And they're very reliable and predictable. Whereas with a digital audio workstation, most of the time that's not the case. So for many years I've been using, you know, expensive plugins and complicated plugins just to find myself in a session that I don't want to work in anymore, because I'm afraid that clicking something will break it, or that it will crash, or even if I had a melody in my head, I couldn't actually play it because the latency was too big. So we don't have to go through this. It's very easy to sample yourself. As you can hear, this is the original Kontakt library with Kontakt loaded up here. And here are the original MIDI notes of the bass. However, this track is disabled. I'm not using it, and I recorded it just in Ableton. It's super easy to do. Basically, you just create another audio track, set the input to whatever you want to record. Usually post effects is what I choose. And you record it. My Kontakt doesn't load up right now, but this would be actually all we had to do. So if we press record, it would record the bass if I had Kontakt loaded up. And that took 30 seconds, and I suggest you really do this, especially if you're loading up some bigger plugins, because then you get your own sample that you can work with and that you can loop, and it's 0% on the CPU. You can play around with it all day, it's super fast, and it will make your life a lot easier. And you can always go back if you want to. So the way I do it is when I go to the current project folder in Ableton, and it should be the case with any DAW. How many of you here use Ableton? Couple. Okay, nice, amazing. Of course this goes with any DAW, but this is how I do it in Ableton. Basically I create a new folder in current project and I call it unused. And then all the random stuff from the session that I come up with during songwriting, I put in here. For example, I could put in the bass from Kontakt in this folder, save it, and delete it, right? And I still have the sample. And I think this is super important during songwriting, to back your instruments up in a way that you can find them if you want to, and take the pressure off you, because if I know that it's somewhere there, I can still go back and change the sound if I really have to. But it also enables me to, you know, freeze the sound and work from the sample from here on. Processing wise, there's not too much going on with the bass, a bit of compression and EQing. The next thing I want to show on this track is some guitar recordings. I don't play the guitar, but I recorded some small parts. it's not great, but it's somewhere in the background. So I would suggest that you, if you do songwriting, sometimes it helps to have something hands-on, something you can hold, something you can play around with, and you don't have to record everything in one take. You can, as you can see, these are a lot of different takes. And then, you know, together they make the lead sound for me. And that's why I put them in a group again. So now, even though it's four layers, it is very simple for me to edit them all together and to do stuff with them. Yeah. With vocals, I have one thing here I want to show you. I think it's in this group though. Yeah, I have some reverse vocal effects. This used to be just a vocal with the delay on it. I don't even know what it says anymore, but it's one of those things that I wouldn't know how to replicate any other way. And they stick with the track. Yeah, so there's only so far you can get with MIDI and with synthesizers and with notes and chords. If you don't dive into the sample area, you will miss out on it. So ideally, I'd say you just use the best of both worlds and use samples and MIDI and stuff like that, but also record audio, whether it's an external synthesizer or inside of Ableton, or you hum something into the microphone or something like that. For that, I also have a session that I want to show you. This is all unfinished, still working on it, but I do believe this one will come out. Of course, most songs that we all work on never come out, and that's fine, but I hope this one does come out. The main element is this arp from Diva, and as you can see, there's some automation on the cutoff here, which is actually, I recorded it with the Ableton Push, but you could record it with any MIDI controller. But I would suggest you have one MIDI controller or anything. It doesn't have to be an expensive one. You only need like two knobs would be nice. And just map some stuff and record it, and you will come up with some great ideas. Unfortunately, you have to do like a little workaround in Ableton to record just MIDI, which is something that has been annoying me for a while. If I want to record automation here now, it's hard to see it right now, but it created a second MIDI clip. Basically, it overwrites the MIDI clip and creates a new one, which is quite annoying, especially if you have some stuff lying around here that's beyond the loop, and then if you override it, then you have a new MIDI clip, and you might lose some information that you want to, and it just creates these weird little things in the session that don't look nice. So you either create an empty MIDI track and record on there. Then you jump back to the main synth, and then I can automate it and it actually works. Even though I'm recording the empty MIDI track. And I would suggest you just go through your tracks and automate some stuff. Either some cutoffs or maybe some sends or stuff like that. The alternative would be, if you don't want to create a second MIDI track, you could set the input to no input. Now I can't play anything anymore, but now it won't override the MIDI clip if I record. Yeah, I mean, these are two workarounds for the same problem. But in the end of the day, if you have some automation, it's going to be a lot more organic. One other thing that is really nice to automate, it should be somewhere in here, I think. Well, I can't find it right now. Doesn't matter. One core element of this track are these vocal snippets. And that's actually me humming into the microphone three times. and then I duplicated it one time in the middle, one time on the left, one time on the right. Of course, some autotune on there. If you don't have autotune, this is a free autotune plugin. You can check it out. It's not as good as the Antares autotune, but it's free, and for my users, it's enough. And if you upgrade, you can make this message here disappear, which is also nice. And the cool thing about the sound happens by, well, we can listen to one of the things in solo. I mean, it doesn't sound like me anymore because it's going through a little Alter Boy by Sound Toys. They make amazing plugins. You don't need them, of course, but at the same time, I think they have a lot of plugin companies have a sale right now because of Black Friday. So for the price, it's really amazing. And even without the price, it's really cool. Basically, the drive here is really distorting everything out of the signal. And it's a monophonic voice manipulation tool, as it says here. So it tries to follow the pitch, but of course, it's hard for it to follow the pitch because I'm sending three different audio tracks in it that all have a slightly different pitch. And somewhere in its weirdness and trying to get the pitch right, even though it can't really decide, it creates this type of sound, which I like. And I think that's another thing about sound design and arrangement, is always trying to do things that you shouldn't be doing or that aren't meant to be done in a specific way, and see what mistakes the sound processor will come up with. And oftentimes that will be the most interesting sounds. For the bass, in this track I actually recorded this synthesizer right here, which is a Behringer Model D. When I bought the synthesizer, it was the first one I bought. I thought it would make my tracks a lot better, but it didn't, and I wasn't even using it much. Just realized that basically it's just a normal sound and I don't need the synthesizer to make it. However, over the years, you kind of learn some nice little things with it that you can't quite get with a plugin, and then it's nice to use it. So the way I would record the synthesizer is exactly how I did it here. It doesn't have a keyboard, as many other synthesizers don't have a keyboard. And I guess for some people hate that. Personally, I like that because it keeps my desk free with space. So I can play melodies on the push or in MIDI here, and they will be played by the synthesizer with the external instrument. And it's how I prefer to record synthesizers. You can, of course, create an audio track and record it in there, but this way it supposedly gets plug-in delay compensated, and it's a bit nicer to look at. And then all the effects of the plugin, of the synth, go into this group. So basically, either I'm playing it live through the external instrument and the sound is coming right through. We can actually do this right now. Should work, I think. Yeah. This audio track right here, which is recording the sound from Synth Live, which has the external instrument. And this way it's just super easy to quickly record your synth right into the drum, into the track below it. I just have to press record. And now, as you can see, it's recording the new sound. And when I'm done, you just disable the external instrument and you have all your sounds frozen in here. This is what we just recorded. Amazing. And with the new take lanes, it's also really nice because you can see, if you open them up, when show take lanes, you can see all the different edits you made. This is how it looks in this session. Basically, I just recorded some snippets and then looped them throughout the whole track. But the thing with external instruments is it can be a nice thing for songwriting because you have some actual knobs to play around with and it looks nice and it's inspiring and all of that. But at the same time, it is hard enough to keep a normal session organized. And once you actually start using external instruments, you will have a lot more stuff to organize. You will have 20 different takes. You will have, maybe you will want to change one note in the MIDI track, but then you can't get the sound anymore the same way it was, or you're trying to find one version and you can't find it anymore and the deadline is in 2 days and you're getting stressed. So I mean, it's nice, but it will definitely make your workflow a bit, it will force you to tidy up your session even more if you use analog equipment, in my experience. So if you want some cool organic sounds, you don't actually have to get analog stuff. I think you really should just organize your session and experiment with the features that Ableton already has. I have one pretty cool sound I stumbled upon a while ago. It's from one of these tracks. Wait, which one was it? This one. No, I don't think it was this one actually. Yeah, it was this one. So this is another track. It might be part of an EP with the track I showed you just now. The session is quite big, but let's hope it loads up nicely. One really cool sound in this that I really like is this pad, I think. I call it Pad Demons because it's super scary. And this is coming from a vocal sample. I think it was another take of the session where I recorded the humming. This sound doesn't actually, like, it doesn't sound like anything. It sounds quite boring. But by playing around with the chorus effect in Ableton and putting the feedback to 99%, sounds pretty crazy. And then by adding the Valhalla preset of the Ableton's resonator, it creates this sound. And it doesn't really have anything to do anymore with the original. And if someone showed this to me, I would have no idea how they made this exact sound. And I think it's really interesting. Even though both of these tools are super old, I mean, this is the new chorus, but it's basically the same one as the old one, and the resonator has also been part of Ableton for, I don't know, 10 years or so. You actually have some really crazy sound design tools here, especially if you kind of use them creatively. Another interesting part about this project right here is that there's been a lot of versions of it. If you want to see them, this is how it started. And I would suggest if you do any songwriting or arrangement, each time that you start something new, you save the project under a new name. This way you can completely freely do whatever you want. You can mess everything up. You can change all the melodies because it doesn't matter. You have the old version of it. It helps to create like a free atmosphere where you can just have fun. Essentially, this is how this song here started. have much to do with the session right now anymore. But this one part, I thought this was like the coolest part of it, and it comes in at the very end here, 3 minutes 30. So it took me then a couple versions to realize, you know, that was actually the coolest part. Let me center the whole track around that instead of keeping it the way it was in the demo. And if for some reason I don't like what I did, I can still always go back and go back to the original. The way the arrangement changed for this track is it kind of became a symmetrical arrangement. There is this sort of A melody or A part, or this time it's called B because it's less important than the A part, even though it's coming in first. So I thought this would be like a nice intro to pave the way for the main melody. If you have something cool and something that you like, maybe you shouldn't hit your listener with it right away, but kind of introduce it slowly until the time is right, until everyone is waiting for it. So the way this song is arranged is there is this B part, which is in the beginning. Well, this is the intro, then there's some drums in the B part, and then it turns into the A part, which is the main chorus. Then this goes on for 2 minutes. Then there's a transition part of it. It's called here transition. And then it goes back into the B part, which has the same progression as the B part in the beginning. That's maybe not exactly the standard song layout, if you take some of the songs you like, and you should do it, just check their arrangement and divide them into different parts and kind of analyze not only the structure, like when does the kick come in, at what minute, but also what are the underlying chords. For example, if we take, a random track that we like, well, let's go for Adam Port. You can just drag it in, and then you can kind of create little parts, like just cut the audio and name the parts. For example, intro. Then here we have. Kick comes in. This is, I would call this part the verse. Everyone calls this stuff differently, and I think there have been arguments with other people from music who are like in bands, and they call the bridge something else than what I would call the bridge, and the verse would be something else again. But ideally, you just find a way that works for you. So when you hear someone else's tracks and you want to find out why you like it, you can divide it into parts and sort of understand what exactly it is that you like and how you can do it in your own music as well. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. Most of 99% of songs are the same anyway, because they have to be, because we have to be able to listen to them on, you know, headphones and a mobile phone and in the club, and they have to be 3 to 6 minutes long, and they all have an intro and an outro. They share a ton of stuff, so yeah, I would suggest look up some tracks that you really like and create something like this for yourself, where you label everything. And then if you wanna kind of find out why you like it, I would also suggest you try to replicate the melodies that you hear in them, which is actually quite hard. I did this like a long time ago, and I couldn't figure it out. I was hearing the melody and I was trying to replicate it, and I didn't get it right at all, and it took me a long time to kind of slowly learn it, because it seems so simple. It's like such a simple melody, and you have to be able to play it, right? But I couldn't do it at all. And for example, if we now try to quickly redo the melody with a completely different plugin, but and I mean, it's something like this, I guess. Something like that, and then the loops. If you can sort of recreate that for all the tracks that you like, and most of the time you'll find that the notes itself are very simple, but it can be still very hard to actually find them. For some reason, but I guess that's the skill that would be nice to learn. Like if you hear a chord or you hear a melody, that you can actually put it down. And then I think it will be a super big help for songwriting to learn that skill. Because if you can hear a melody in another song and you can, then you have to memorize it in your head first, and then you have to put it inside the DAW. It also means that you can put things from your head into the software. So whenever you have a melody in your head, it also means that you can easily put it down, which is essentially, I think, what songwriting is. We already started making a small melody. I can also show you more sessions, but I thought maybe now we'll make a short track and I'll show you exactly how I would go about creating chords and melodies, not just in already finished tracks, but right here and right now. There are many different approaches. Ideally, you will find one or two that work for you, no matter what and where and when. If you know this plugin, this is a piano plugin. It's free. Quite a lot of people use it. It's nice if you play it. Super soft piano. Usually when you open up a piano plugin, it's very loud and unpleasant, but this one is very soft. And this thing right here is the Ableton Push. I use it instead of a MIDI keyboard, but of course if you can play the piano, and I would suggest it probably would be nice to learn an actual instrument, then of course use that. But for me, I find this quite inspiring. I don't know, it lights up nicely, and I do like how it looks and how it works. One way to go about chords for me is to just start making them and then later thinking about actually how I would arrange them. So I usually build them up note by note from starting somewhere. And now we have a little chord right here. Then you can set the clip quantization somewhere here. They changed the menu now, I can't find anything anymore, but oh yeah, quantize none. And now you have this chord laid out on the session view of Ableton. If you have a launchpad, you can do this. Even if you don't have any controller, you can map these slots here to your keys. For example, I can map it to the letter K. That took 5 seconds, and now I have something nice to play around with. Of course, you don't have to map it if you have a controller anyway. So let's write a second chord. Two, maybe let's just make three or four other ones. I don't really know what I'm going for. Oftentimes you will find out in the end which two or three are the coolest ones.
Do you go by any scale or just pick some random
note? I guess the scale we're in is D. Yeah, D. But I'm not in any scale, and the reason why is because sometimes I change the scale throughout the song, or I mean the scale by song. I don't know all the music theory details, but a lot of scales share different chords together. And so if I already now I said, okay, I'm going to use this scale, then I'm kind of limited to it. Whereas sometimes if I do it completely without a scale, which is how I do it, in the middle of a track, I will see, oh yeah, actually it sounds better if I use this chord instead of the other one. And then the whole progression becomes actually part of another scale. And these accidents wouldn't have happened if I would have used the scale from the beginning. But of course, it's also very personal. Everyone does it differently. And this is just to show how I do it. Different. Sometimes it's nice to kind of go in reverse. Now I've built the first one, then the second one, then the third one. And sometimes it's nice to actually play them in reverse and just see if maybe there are some other patterns that are nice. So let's just record this one. I'm not feeling it 100%, but also you kind of just have to start somewhere and then see where it goes. So the way I would record this is turn on the metronome and record it. And now we have this little progression in the timeline. Of course, it's not on time, it's not quantized, but you can easily do that. Okay, that didn't quite work. Okay, so this, I think this is all right as a starting point, even though it will definitely change in the end. Another sound design or arrangement trick is to add a filter. I always do it. Somehow it's nice because you still have the vibes playing in the background, but it kind of leaves a bit more stuff up to interpretation, especially if you want to add elements and you might have a piano in the beginning that you might want to have out later on, but it kind of helps to have something playing to come up with new ideas. And also always very nice to just add a delay. This time I'm just using Ableton's delay. Okay, one more thing that's also nice to do is, music theory wise, I think it's always like the lowest note of a chord that ultimately determines what chord it is. And I don't mean the actual lowest note that's in the MIDI file, but like the root note of it that you would kind of imagine or play if you would play a bass line to it. This is the note that essentially defines the vibe of a chord. So if we have this piano here playing, basically this is our bass line. And it's okay, but it can be very nice to remove it and just try if we can come up with a new bass line. And in return, we oftentimes will get a lot more different or creative chord progressions because essentially it will completely shift around the vibe of the chords. think this is what I meant with the key. Now that I removed the lowest note, I guess there's just a couple notes in here, and a lot of different keys share these notes inside the key. So by not defining the key from the beginning, now I can kind of freely write a bass line to this. And it might end up being in another key than the chords originally were in. But let's record a bass line, and I'll use the... Oh, that's actually the wrong thing. This is it. Let's record the synthesizer, because I also want to show you how I do that. If you have synthesizers, I would suggest you use the MIDI input, because you can daisy chain them so you don't have 10 USB devices. Let's see if this works. Amazing. Oh yeah, it's the wrong channel. The good thing about this synthesizer is it always sounds pretty good. It's the classic Moog bot synth sound. Some people love it, some people hate it. But you definitely can't go wrong with it. And the synth has a very wide sweet spot. Basically, anything you do with it sounds pretty good. Some notes. This. And that's it. Just one note, one fast note. It doesn't have to be the main element of the track, but could be something that adds a bit of character, is somewhere in the track. Let's listen to the whole thing. Unfortunately, it's clicking a little bit, but maybe that's something nice that we will end up liking in the finished track. Let's add a delay as usual. Echo has actually some pretty cool presets if you know. Well, I mean, if you use Ableton, it's certainly worth checking out the default sounds. Well, maybe not this one, but... if you know Silent One, it's a pretty old plugin. It's probably considered vintage at this point, but it used to be like a famous EDM plugin back in the day, and it's still a nice plugin. It's super light on the CPU, which is the reason why I particularly like it. And if you play around with stuff like this, you will realize quite quickly that a lot of the sounds in electronic music are just saw waves with a bit of filtering and stuff on them. One thing that's always nice to add is a bit of pitch automation. You can do it right here, and any plugin has it. Maybe it's called vibrato or something, but makes it sound kind of more organic, fake analog sound. Okay, let's make a pad sound. So yeah, this part to me feels like an intro. The time is kind of standing still. Could be nice, maybe at the beginning of a song, but it doesn't really say much yet. Which is sometimes exactly what you want. You don't always want to say something. So I would imagine this would be like the intro. Maybe there's like some drums in the background, and then at some point there will be the main progression. Maybe then this chord again. Okay, I think this could be like the main progression of the song. Let's add a bass. I imagine like a bouncy bass that's just playing super simple sounds, kind of like a Anjuna Deep sound bass. Thank you. let's add a lead sound or something like that. Let's start with a triangle for this one. It has some drum kits and they're perfectly fine to work in demos. Just pick any drum pack just for laying out a rhythm, because it's hard to lay down chords without rhythm. Oh, wow. If you have a MIDI controller, it's nice to record drums with it, because as you can see, by pressing on the pad, it changes the velocity of it, so you don't have to go in by hand and actually do it in Ableton, which is one plus of using a controller, is you kind of get this human quality to it for free without actually doing anything and having to like jump in and use the mouse. Change the volume. Yeah, looks like our session is broken. Yeah, seventh one. I updated to the new Mac when it came out. Maybe it's because of that. But, well, maybe it's time to say goodbye. Well, that one was probably Beatport number one chart, and now we will never see it again. Yeah, we can recover it. Amazing. Okay, one more little sound design or arrangement thing I want to show you is playing around with an arpeggiator. Ableton has a lot of MIDI effects, and you can actually use them creatively as well. Ideally, I would say, is when you use stuff like this, you play around with it, but then in the end you bounce it back to MIDI. So you can have a lot of fun with an arpeggiator and stuff like that, but ideally, just like with samples, you want to bounce them in the end to have the file, and with MIDI files as well, especially if you have some randomness going on there. And then you have to export it, because the deadline is in 2 days, and all the cool parts suddenly disappeared because they were random, because it's not like a fixed MIDI file. That would suck. So play around with these things, and you can actually record them as MIDI as well, which is what I'm going to show you. So first, I'll use these chords as a source for the arpeggiator, and let's add the same sound over here. So let's play around with the rate of the arpeggiator and record that. Well, this is not amazing, but now that we have the automation, which you can see here, we can create another audio track or MIDI track. And you can set the input to 10 seventh one, because this is where the arpeggiator is, and set it to post effects. And as you can see, it's recording the actual MIDI. And this way we have a complexity that we would never have had otherwise. And it's still very controllable. We can quantize some parts of it if we want to. We don't have to quantize the whole thing. Another very nice thing to add is randomness to velocity. So we can just move the silence to the new chords we have. Let's add a MIDI effect for velocity and randomize it. Here's a random knob. And in silence, we can say that the velocity is set to the cutoff. Some randomness going on there, and now we can again record the MIDI file and maybe even the audio file, and then we'd have the velocity bounced in there as well. There's one more cool thing I want to show you, which is really like an old tool that everyone was using, and I think some people are still using it. It's called Pulse Stretch. Does anyone know it? Nice. Okay. It still works under the new macOS. I don't know how or why, because everything else is broken, but this tool for some reason still works. What you need is you have to feed it some audio. We will just feed it this sound for now. So we'll sample it the way I would usually sample stuff in Ableton. Make a new audio track, record it. This is Pulse Stretch. Looks amazing. Very inviting to do stuff with it. The interface, you'll have to get used to it a bit, but let's set it up in a way that we can actually play around with it. Basically, I create another audio track to record the Pulse Stretch. Post effects, record. It looks good to me. And now we can just drag in the MIDI file, the audio file we just did. And now I'm recording the output of Pulse Stretch as well while I'm playing with it. You can stretch the audio in different amounts. You can slow down really to a crazy amount where you have a 3-minute song and it becomes a 80-hour version or something. So the stretching is super intense. You can play around with noise and tonal frequencies. I'm sure there's a manual somewhere if you want to look it up. But with this, you can create some really cool soundscapes. For example, now this is a pretty cool sound. We could put reverb on it, we could pitch it. Like free yoga meditation music. in 30 seconds. And you can create some pretty crazy sounds with it. One thing I did with it that I want to show you, I'll save the session for now. Okay. It's this song with, again, with Space Cadet. We're still working on the vocals, so it's not final, but there are some cool vocal effects I did with Paul Stretch that I want to show you as well. This is what the song sounds like. I'll skip the vocals because they're not final. The cool vocal part should be in the pad group, I think. Yeah, so this is what the vocal sounded like first. Caught in my bedroom, there's something up under my bed. After some effects and EQing, I just recorded them. And then there's somewhere, I think I already deleted Paul Stretch because there is no stop button on the plugin. It will always keep running. So usually you record it, then you freeze it and you delete the track again. But just by running through, letting these vocals run through it, I made sounds like this. Which is, I don't know, super crazy. I haven't heard stuff like this before. It's perfect for an outro or a breakdown, super epic. And the cool thing about editing samples like that is it will never be completely different. It will always share some characteristics with the original. For example, the high note is there because he actually sung this high note. So it will be in the same key. It will have some characteristics that will keep it connected to the original. Go through the layers just so you can see them. On one, as usual, the vocals are on the top. Here up top is the reference group for mixing. I don't exactly use it a ton, but sometimes after a long session, even after a short session, you kind of lose the feeling in your ears of what's normal and what's not, and it helps to have one or two tracks that you like and just have them up here. I think now the track I chose is Inner Bloom by Rufus Du Sol, which is an amazing track. I think they won a Grammy for it as well. Yeah, this is amazing track. And basically, the way I have it set up is I mapped the button T to solo on the reference group. So each time I want to listen to it, I just have to press T and then, you know, find the right volume. And I mean, yeah, it sounds great, and it's an easy way to keep your ears fresh, and most importantly, listen to the song that you're comparing it with in a similar volume, which is why right now it's in minus 12 dB. Then we have the vocal group, couple effects on there. The SEQ, if you know it. Does anyone know the SEQ or Sooth? Sooth, maybe? Yeah, okay. So yeah, the SEQ is like Sooth. It's resonant, it finds resonance, it's in your sound. And it suppresses them intelligently. I can show you what it does right here. It looks like an EQ, but in fact what it does, it's an attenuator for the input processing of the plugin. If you press the triangle, I don't know why it's a triangle, but it shows you what it removes. Some really random resonant frequencies that you would not be able to catch with an EQ because they move. Sooth is a similar plugin. Sooth is twice expensive, and so I bought the SEQ. There's also other plugins that are similar, but as I said, it's nice to work with samples and to record samples. And however, you will run into problems that you didn't have before. If you use synthesizers or plugins, oftentimes you don't get these resonances. But with samples, because you have a microphone and you have a room and you have room modes, you will get problems that you didn't have before. And sometimes it's nice to have a plugin like this to fix them, but also all these plugins, they're not that good. It's certainly not something you should put on every track. It's more of a final solution that can sometimes work, sometimes it can't. But it's nice to see that there are these new tools that haven't been there before.
Do you use this for vocals?
Most of the time, these problems, I don't get them from other sounds, because you know, as I said, if it's coming from digital or something, there is no resonance, room modes, or recording problems because it's not being recorded. I have used it on stuff like guitars, which is, again, something that has been recorded. Other than that, I don't think I have ever used it on anything else because all the other sounds are coming from samples or stuff like that. And if there's a hi-hat sample I don't like, I'll just use a different hi-hat sample rather than trying to fix this. Because in the end, it has like 1,000 different equalizers in there that are like linear phase, and it does introduce quite a lot of artifacts, even on the high quality settings. So, I mean, it's a more of an emergency solution. For the ARP, there is this sound right here. This one is Silent One. A lot of people always ask, like, what's the best plugin and stuff like that, but I'd say it really doesn't matter. It's just nice to know one of them pretty well. One thing I really enjoy doing lately is adding some distortion on the tracks. Well, you probably know the Soundtrace plugins, but it could be any plugin. And the magic really lies in distorting it really heavily, but adding the mix just to a little bit, just slightly adding the distortion. This way you can have the best of both worlds. Basically, you have a sound with character, and that, you know, sizzle or something in the top end, but you still have a very clean signal because most of the sound that's coming through is still a dry signal, not a wet signal from the distortion. This is what the distortion does in this case. This is full wet, and this is without it. So yeah, quite a big difference. And for this sound, I have it somewhere right here, the dry-wet knob. Ideally, if you do this, you would gain stage it in a way that you set the plugin, you turn it on, you set it to full wet, and ideally, the volume doesn't change a lot if you go from dry to wet. This way it's super easy to find the right sweet spot, because if you don't do this, for example, if the output here was on a zero, what's the standard is, it's probably going to be a bit loud. It gets a lot louder, and no one can find a sweet spot if the volume changes by, I don't know, 20 dB, then it's going to be really hard to find a cool sound. So you have to gain adjust it, but if you do it, then it's really nice. Okay, lead group. There's a small melody right here. It's from Operator, which is from Ableton. It's a preset that I then changed a little bit. And the sound is just here one single time. It doesn't come back. It doesn't do anything else. And it kind of accompanies the vocals in the verse. So I think that's another thing. Sometimes it's nice to have unique elements that are just maybe in one place in the track or in two, especially considering that all tracks are getting shorter anyway. And they have to be exciting, and you know, people have to listen to them and like them right away for the algorithms. So by adding a couple of unique sounds, you can keep the listener interested throughout the whole song. It's a deep arpeggio with some effects on it. And even though it plays the same melody all the time, in the drop, in the very last part of the drop, it's being layered by another lead. Hardly noticeable, but it adds a little bit to the atmosphere of the song. For the pads, I already showed you the vocals. Then there is the main pluck of the song, which for this sound I use Diva, but it's basically just a sine wave. It could be any plugin. A lot of cool sounds are super simple. Here are the MIDI notes. I think this is my favorite sound of the song. It's from Labs. It's a Resonator music box. Again, this plugin is free, so it's pretty nice to check it out. It's also a nice source for samples. I usually, when I use it, I sample it, because it is a bit unpredictable in the way it triggers the notes. It kind of adds some randomness to them, which isn't always nice. This track actually started completely differently. This is what it sounded like in the beginning. So yeah, it's a very different track, and after a couple of versions, it became this track. But it's still nice to see that some, even though the chords change, and I guess the key did not change, but the chords change and the sounds change, some elements like this pluck still is in there in the new version. Yeah. But in my bedroom, there's something up under my bed. And so on. I think there's one last track I want to show you for the session that I've been working on. It is the track, should be, one of these, I think 238. Probably. Yeah, I think it's a nice nice track as the final one for the session. This is what it sounds like. on, and the sort of main element of the track is some bells from here. These bells are from Labs as well. I do like this plugin. The magic happens though again in the Little Alter Boy plugin. So without the plugin, they sound like this. And on the plugin, I put the formants down, which is not something I planned, but you just have to experiment with it. Sometimes it's nice to transpose the whole melody one octave up and then put the formants down. Sometimes it's nice to do it the other way. In this case, I did it this way, that I shifted the melody one octave up and then put the formants down. And it sounds cool. I don't know even what instrument it sounds like. I mean, kind of bells, but it's got some randomness to it. And even though it's coming from a free plugin with a that a lot of people use, by editing it, you can definitely get it to sound unique. You can also hear the delay in the sound is quite strong. Yeah, I mean, without it, again, the element loses a lot of its energy or a lot of its character. Consists of two layers. Basically, there's the lead in here, and there's also another sound that just plays one note. And in the very last drop, I sampled the bell, and I pitched it four semitones in this case, and created this melody thing right here. This is coming from the same bells. And of course, this isn't any plugin. This is just sampling it and pitching the samples that you can see here into a melody that I like. Yeah, it's again something I wouldn't have done with any plugin. It has to be done with samples. Same thing goes here for the strings. This is the string chord progression. This is just a random sample. We can listen to the sample by itself.
There's no secret.
Okay. But by taking the last part of the sample, we can play chords with it. But yeah. Just taking the last syllable and then basically you can play this chord with it. And it doesn't sound anything like a voice anymore. But also it sounds interesting because it has some quality from the voice in it, even though it doesn't sound anymore like the voice. And then, as I showed you before, there's a delay on it that adds a lot of rhythm to it. It's frozen into the sample. I can't disable it, or maybe I can actually. Yeah. Okay. For the drums, I recorded some of them myself. With I don't know what that was, like a can of something of some sort in my room. Yeah. Here you can see another folder of unused drums. So all of these I can basically deactivate. I don't have to look at them. And whenever I find an element that's unimportant or I don't like, I just put it either down here or I deleted out of the session in itself altogether. Yeah, the vocal is coming from a sample. Let's listen to the full sample. What? I think it has some automation on it. Yeah. I don't know what it says or which language this is, but a really powerful way to work with samples is to use the envelopes in Ableton. And the cool thing is you can link them to anything. It doesn't have to be the clip gain. You can make envelopes in here in the clip view for any parameter of any plugin in the chain. So I could even EQ 8 boost like a band or something if I want to. Well, can't hear it now, but it's super powerful, especially if you combine it with automation. Yeah, and basically that's the whole track. There's the lead. And the bass. This was everything I wanted to show you today. I hope there have been a couple of small things that maybe, probably a lot of them you already knew, maybe some of them you found interesting. I hope it showed how I like to work and also how random it is how I work, how unpredictable it can be, and how important it is to just kind of save what you do, and then when it comes to being creative, to just have fun and see where it takes you. Thank you for listening. Do you have any questions?
So for your vocal production, aside from the mixing and stuff and the technical stuff, what's your level of involvement with the vocalist and songwriting and all that stuff?
I haven't done many vocal songs yet. The vocal songs that I have done were mostly remixes, so the involvement there is basically zero. You get the stems and you hope that they're okay. I have done a couple of vocal songs, one with Benzina that's already out, and it kind of really depends on the artist. Well, usually I absolutely leave the lyrics to the vocalist, and then it is a little bit of a back and forth. Sometimes I ask for a different version, record it slightly differently, but most of the time I try to stay out of it, especially because I've made the experience that the more I try to say, like it gets worse, it doesn't get better. Ideally, the vocalist does his or her thing, and usually that's always a lot better than when I try to make like suggestions and then no one likes the result in the end. Okay,
Test, perfect. So I've watched one of your masterclasses online as well, and what I noticed is that your mixes sound super clean. I was super impressed, and the question is basically what is your approach to mixing? What's your general first steps that you use? I don't know. There's no secrets, and I know mixing is a lot of just learning and going on. But is there any default things kind of that you do to get a clean mix?
Yeah, thank you. I mean, first of all, I wouldn't praise my mixes myself as much, especially when I hear them. I always hear, like, I'm never really happy with them. And I do think there's quite a lot of stuff I have to learn. So there are mixing engineers who have been doing it for 30, 40 years. They are absolute experts. I'm also just trying to somehow get it right. For me, the biggest Well, the biggest thing for mixing is to split the sessions up. I've had times where I had a deadline, and then I would think, okay, I'll mix the track in one day, and it just got worse and worse, and it happened not once, but probably 10, 20, 30 times that I wake up the next morning and I listen to what I did, and it's really bad, and basically I can restart the whole thing. So my suggestion is keep your ears fresh, make short sessions, change a lot of things, but only change them slightly. So basically, if I wanted to mix this, I would save it under a new name, and then just fix tiny details instead of going all in and soloing one element and focusing on that. I would just go through the track and whatever announces itself to me as not being perfect, change it a little bit, and then save it, export it, take a 10-minute break, and then do the whole thing from the start. So make, you know, a lot of different sessions, and then it's going to be a lot easier than trying to do the whole thing at once.
So does generally the process takes a little bit more time, so you split it up over time?
Yeah, I think the people who are really super pros, they know their ears so well that they can mix a whole song in a couple of hours, and they know it sounds great, and they don't have to go do revisions. But I think the point to get there is to make lots of revisions, because yeah, there isn't really no way around it. I think if you need 20 years or so if you really want to trust your ears, and ideally you haven't broken them before that by going to loud concerts. So yeah, just make lots of sessions.
Thank you.
Okay, I think there's no more questions. Okay. So yeah, thanks again for being here. I hope there have been one or two pieces of advice that were cool and nice to look at. I hope you enjoy the rest of your stay here at the Riverside, and maybe I'll see you later somewhere at the SIE or somewhere here at Riverside. Enjoy the rest of the day.